Good afternoon. Great to see everybody. I hope you're enjoying Baku. It's my first time in Baku. I'm impressed. It's really, really nice. The decisive decade. So we are we're in the middle of the decisive decade. In 2 months, it'll be 2025, which is that's pretty scary given how much we need to do. I have one chart just to illustrate that. On the left, you'll see historic emissions, energy-related emissions. On the right, you'll see the pathways. We have one, which is the economic transition pathway. So that's where economics alone will take us. So that's a downward trend, but that's to 2.6 degrees C. So that's not where we want to be. If we want to be on net zero, which for us is a 1.75 degrees C pathway, we need to reduce emissions by 37% in the next 5 years. So that really is the steep challenge. So we're really into implementation. And actually, we've been thinking about this for a few years now. And actually, we came up with a methodology to start to think about implementation, because we cover 33 different commodities and technologies. Every transition is different by different geographies. This is a complex task. So the idea was to break this task down. If you're going to do a plan, you need to break the task down. And our methodology breaks it down into four pillars. You'll see those 1 to 4 there. So pillar one was deploying mature technologies. There are many technologies that work, that are cheap, cost-effective, just need to be rolled out very rapidly. Pillar two was around developing new technologies, bringing the cost curves down for some of these first-of-a-kind type projects, phasing out, transitioning, shifting from carbon-intensive to low-carbon, and finally putting a governance structure and some measurements around that. And you sort of need to do all of those four things. So if you need to do a transition plan, you can create these four buckets, and you need to think about activities that go in it. We actually have a whole methodology behind that with this report here that says for each of the key industries, what are the challenges in each bucket and what are the policies? We have 70-odd different policies online to help. But you can use it not just for policy, but also for implementation overall. So the short version of this is deploy, develop, shift, and measure. So those are my four shorthands for this methodology. And if we look at the deploy area, then what you see is that these are the technologies we'd need to decarbonize. And by 2050, 45% of it's to do with clean power. So clean power is basically half of the challenge. If you cut that back to 2030, I'll do this a number of times, it's over half. It's 55% of clean power. So when you're spending time on decarbonizing, half your time should be spent on this question alone. And quite a lot of progress has been made. So if you look last year in terms of capacity additions, only 6% of capacity additions were fossil fuel based, which is pretty amazing. So 91% were wind and solar, 94% were clean technologies. So that's pretty amazing. And if you look at what's happened with the key technologies, so wind and solar, you'll see solar has been 2.8-fold. So this is 2.8 times increase in the last 4 or 5 years. And we believe that to continue. The learning rate for solar is 28%. So for every doubling capacity, it gets 28% cheaper. You'll see on the right there, wind has also been scaling dramatically. So again, these are numbers of type fold increases, huge increases, and it's a 14% learning rate for wind. So again, for every doubling capacity, it gets 14% cheaper. If you look at energy storage, that's even steeper. So that's been a 9-fold increase just since 2020, which is doesn't seem that long ago, right? A 9-fold increase, and we think it's going to grow another 5-fold between now and the end of the decade. And what that means is that the tripling of renewable capacity, which was one of the COP28 goals, that is in sight. So you look where we were in 2022. You can see what our forecast is for 2030. It's not quite tripling, but it's getting close. So that's about deployment. So really, the questions are about deployment. But there are challenges. So this is showing you what's sitting in the connection queue. So literally, by US grid area or by European country, huge amounts sitting in the queue. There's actually 3 or 4 times as much in the US queue as there is deployed out in the market. So massive amounts sitting in the queue. So getting those connected, getting those permissioned is a real challenge. The other key part of deployment is electrification. which is 23%, or if you think of it just by 2030, 14%. The biggest area of that is electric vehicles. So has the growth rate slowed down? It has, but it's still gonna be 20-odd percent. There are not many global markets growing so fast. Last year, it was 33% in terms of sales of EVs. And again, we think that's gonna keep going. So it's up fivefold first half of the decade. We think it's gonna be up threefold for the rest of the decade. And what that actually means is the chart on the left shows you that internal combustion engine vehicle sales actually peaked in 2017. It was quite a while ago that that was the peak of internal combustion engine vehicle sales. That's pretty amazing, right? And if you look on the right there, what you'll see is peak fuels across all forms of road transport, we believe will peak in about 2027. So we're getting close to that peak. And then the third thing I would talk about on deployment is the blue line is global demand for battery cells and solar modules. The red line is Chinese supply. The Chinese supply is actually double the global demand, which is, again, pretty amazing. So what that means is that prices are only going to come down. So there's going to be a huge drop in prices that will continue. The other thing that's happening is globalization of production. So there's been a big build out. Again, the IRA was one of the key things in the US, but around the world, people starting to build kit. So the other thing that's happening is people building kit in more parts of the world, which will be good for resilience. Will it slow things down? Maybe, but it'll mean when we get there, we'll have a more resilient build out of clean technology. So that's the other piece that I think people are less aware of, but has moved, as we can see, faster than needed, which is good news. So then there's the development question, which is what are the things that are actually much earlier stage? So this is about a fifth of where we need to get to. So between now and the end of the decade. And I'll give you four different examples. So one is CCS. So the good news is we're just starting to see CCS type projects getting signed off and going live. So this is the Northern Lights project, which is in the North Sea. So this is taking CO2 liquefied and pumping it 2.5 kilometers underneath the ocean. You can see it's 1.5 million tons a year, but you can see the amount of increase there is a 178x that we'll need. Now, this project can also scale, and there'll be many others, but you can see where we are in that sort of much earlier stage type of evolution. And that affects the policies you need. It also affects the kind of capital you need. Hydrogen is another example. The bar on the right are what the targets would like to be. This is where we're aiming for. But you can see our forecast is that we'll get to about half of the target. It's not a supply issue. To the right of this is a bar twice the size, which is people working on supply. So the supply is not a problem here. It's about demand. But if you balance those two out, we're going to get about half of the way there. Again, early stage, we'll see how that plays out. The third example is on the right-hand side of this chart is commercial vehicles. So you can see on the left-hand side, two-wheelers, buses, passenger vehicles we talked about. The dark line in the middle is percent of sales. So you'll see it's only 6% of sales are commercial vehicles. But what you'll see is that's 41% emissions. So really, again, that is in the development phase, unlike passenger vehicles, which is in rollout. Again, different kind of money, different kind of policies. And the final example, of course, is sustainable aviation fuel. We all know about, I'm presuming not many people came here on the train. So we know where the demand is. It's really the supply issue. So again, the green bar here shows you sort of the most simple supply in terms of waste oils, but that only gets you to low percents. So again, things like biofuels, those kinds of things really, really need to be scaled up. So that's the develop. And then we talk about shifting. And what the example here I'm going to use is carbon pricing. So we're actually now up to nearly a quarter of emissions are covered by some form of carbon market. And since last 20 years, actually pretty much exactly 20 years, 2005 when the EU ETS started. And actually, that was one of the drivers in the last coal-fired power station in the UK closing down. So that was Radcliffe-on-Soar, which closed down earlier in the year. And carbon pricing, so that was fuel switching out of coal into gas, was played a big part of that. So you can see actually this stuff, you know, it takes time, but it does work. And the EU ETS is actually expanding. So the purple power bars on the right there, those already included in scope. But road transport is about to be added. That's Europe's biggest emitting sector. And buildings, that's the third biggest after power. So again, it's going to be 70-odd percent of emissions that are going to be covered. So again, that's a great example of how carbon markets can be used. But it's not just scope, it's also price. The green band is our estimate of where you need to be in terms of pricing for it to have a material impact. And you'll see the blue line at the top is actually the EU. So not only do they have scope, it's also got the right kind of pricing. So there are many other markets around, but the prices are really too low to have a key impact. And of course, the other thing that's going to affect the shifting is things like the trading challenges with things like tariffs. So in the last sort of week or two, that's been very very much in the press. So really working out how trade between blocks really fits together. So again, that will also have an impact on the transition. And the final point was around measurement. So we need good measures in place if we're going to make this transition. So what this shows you is where have there been targets put in place for net zero? On the left, you can see, so this is still only 2020, which again is pretty amazing. In 2020, look at the red, 66% of emissions had no, there was nothing on it in terms of targets. That's now only 8%. So 92% of emissions are covered by some form of either a commitment or is under discussion. And again, think of what's happened in the last 4 or 5 years in terms of pandemics, inflation, wars, et cetera. That's a pretty amazing progress. But it's not just about that. It's also sustainable. Finance has also been sort of ramping up. The challenge there is lots and lots of rules and regulations have been put in place. Red means it's a mandatory. These are just numbers of. Orange means it's voluntary. But country by country, many different regulations have been put in place. The issue is it's very, very fragmented. So it's not just, it's sort of how do we implement those goals? Those goals are good to have, but then we need to be more organized, more structured about how we actually start to measure those and put in place some more standardized rules. One example of that is we've been doing work on ratios. So ratios seems to be a good way of helping to standardize how we think and how we measure. This is our energy supply banking ratios, which basically says how many dollars of clean investment do you need for every dollar in fossil fuels. And you'll see the blue boxes there will show you. So for this decade, we really should be in a 4-to-1 type ratio. So for every dollar in fossil fuels, we should be investing 4 in clean technologies. We're just under 1-to-1 right now. So again, we have a long way to go, but this ratio can be applied to financial institutions of any shape or size. So again, it's a useful standard measure. There'll be nuances around what's included, and that's normal, but in terms of standardizing, hopefully it's a step in the right direction. So that's sort of how we think about it. To be honest, I use this framework for quite a lot of things. If you have a round table and you're talking about the transition, you can use these four headings, because if you don't, you end up with a very complex discussion with people who will be mixing very different kinds of technologies, very different kinds of policies. It's actually fairly difficult to have a coherent conversation. So I use this kind of structure very often. And if you want the details behind it, please look up this report. So as I say, this report covers many the key industry sectors. It then covers each of the pillars, what are the issues, what are the solutions, and gives some examples, you know, tangible examples of policies that have been put in place. So it's all about implementation now. It's going to be the second half of the decade. It's going to be an interesting ride. We look forward to working with you, and good luck for the rest of COP. Thank you very much.